Now, what is data mining? Data mining is defined as the extraction of the information from the huge amount of data. In other words, we can say that data mining is mining the knowledge from the data. That is, mining the useful information or the useful pattern from the huge amount of data, that is known as the data mining. Now, what are the applications of data mining? Data mining is basically used in market analysis and management, in corporate analysis and risk management, in fraud detection, in production control, science exploration, and many other applications are there in which it can be used. Now, in this project, we are basically analyzing the market basket analysis. That is the most common example of association rule mining, that is market basket analysis. Now, what is this market basket analysis? Market basket analysis is one of the key techniques used by the large retailers to uncover associations between the items. It works by looking for the combination of items that occurs together frequently in transactions. To put it another way, it allows the retailer to identify the relationship between the items that a person buy. For example, you are going to a retailer shop. What is the probability that you will take eggs and you will take the milk? That is, if a person would like to buy milk, then what are the chances or what is the probability that it is also pick or it is also choose bread or eggs? Now, what is association rules? Association rules are widely used to analyze the retail basket or transaction data and are intended to identify strong rules discovered in transaction data using the measure of interestingness based upon the concept of strong rules. That means all these basically the market basket analysis is basically the relationship between the item that the people will buy. That is, it is basically the buying or sort of the relationship between the items that a person would buy when he or she goes to the retail shop. For example, assume that there are 100 customers. 10 of them bought milk, 8 bought butter, and 6 of them bought both. That means 6 persons will buy both milk and butter. Now, what is the basically association rule for that? Bought milk with is basically directly corresponds to bought butter. Now, what is the support for this and what is the confidence and what is the lift for that particular rule? Support would be equals to probability of milk and butter, which is equals to milk and butter, how many people will buy? That is 6. 6 divided by total number of customers is 100. That is corresponds to 0.06. Confidence is basically the support with respect to probability of butter. Probability of butter, how many persons will buy butter is 8. That is, support is 0.06 divided by 0.08. That corresponds to 0.75. Now, what is lift? Lift is basically the confidence divided by the probability of milk. Here, the confidence is 0.75 and the probability of milk is 10% will buy the milk. That is 0.10, which is equals to 7.5. That means in this example is extremely very small. A rule needs that the support of several hundred transactions before it is considered statistically significant, and the data set often contains thousands or millions of transactions. That means in this example, we have taken just a small example of 100 customers. If we will take some thousands or 2000 customer data, then it will show us some other perspective or show us some other statistical data. Now, what is association rule mining? Association rule mining is basically the most common technique that is used for market basket analysis. Now, what is this association rule mining? Association rule mining is a data mining function which discovers the probability of co-occurrence of items in the transactional database. Association rule mining is most important and one of the well-researched technique among the data mining, which was introduced in 1994. For an example of an association rule mining would be, if a customer buy a dozen of eggs, then he is 80% likely to purchase a milk. In the similar way, if a person would buy a dozen of egg, he is 80 to 60% likely to purchase bread also. That means it is basically depends upon the customer perspective, how many things we need to increase in the market and how many things we need to decrease in the market. That is, the things which are rarely used, that are unfrequent items, and the frequent items which are daily used, and each and every customer will buy those items. Now, what is support and confidence in association rule mining? Support of an association rule is basically defined as a percentage, or it is an indication of how frequently that item appears in the database that contains X union Y. That is, support can be calculated by using the formula count of X union Y with respect to count of D. In the similar way, like in the previous example, we have taken that there are 10 of the customers will buy milk and 8 of them will bought butter. That means this one is X, this one is Y, and X union Y is 6. 6 of them will buy both of them. That is, it's X union of Y with respect to count of X. Similar is the count of D. That is, a D is the number of transactions in the database. Now, what is confidence? Confidence is the measure of strength of the association rule. Confidence is defined as a percentage or the fraction of number of transactions in D that contains X also contains Y. That is, it is basically the division of support of X union Y with respect to support of X. Now, algorithms that are used in association rule mining. There are two algorithms which are mostly used in association rule mining, is a priori algorithm and FP growth, that is a frequent pattern growth algorithm. Now we are going to describe in detail, that is the a priori algorithm. A priori algorithm uses a generate and test approach. That is, it will generate the candidate item set, then test if they are frequent or not. And FP growth allows the frequent item set discovery without the generation of candidate set. That is, it uses only the two-step approach. First is build a compact data structure, that is called FP tree. And the second one is extract the frequent item set directly from the FP tree. That is, in the FP growth algorithm, it will basically generate a frequent pattern tree, and we will directly extract the frequent items from that FP tree. Now, in detail, what is a priori algorithm? A priori algorithm involves frequent item sets, which is a set of items appearing together in a given number of database records meeting the user specified threshold. That means it basically depends upon the threshold level of the user. That is, user will specify one minimum threshold level, and it will basically generate the frequent item set on the basis of that minimum support. That means it will reject the item set which have the support count less than that minimum support value or less than that user specified threshold. Now, second is a priori uses bottom up search method that creates every single frequent item set. This means that to produce a frequent item set of length, it must produce all the subset as needed to be frequent. That means it will generate some kind of candidate sets also in order to find the frequent patterns. Now, as an example, we have one input database, that is a D. We have some kind of transactions from 11 till 30 transactions, and each transaction will have some items. Now, we are going to explain how these item sets or how the generation of candidate set will be there. Now, firstly, we have candidate set generation for C1, that is the frequent pattern item set C1. And here we have a minimum support is 56%. We will take 56%, or you can say that we will take the minimum support as 0.56. Now we have, first one is a frequent one item set. That is, here we will take only a single item set. That is A, B, C, D, and E. We have only 5 items in each and every transaction. Now we need to count how many times A will be present, how many times B will be present. Single A will be present in each and every transaction. Single B will be present in each and every transaction. And we will here find the support for A, the support for B, C, D, and E. Here we have taken, calculated the support of A is 65%, B is 70%, similarly C, D, and E. Now here we have taken the minimum support is 56. First candidate set generation is done, and after that we need to test that generation set, that is whether that is that candidate generation set is frequent item set, contains the frequent item sets or not. We will apply the minimum threshold level to the support of that particular candidate set generation. Now here only the transaction, only the item set E is having the minimum support less than 56. Now we will reject that item set E. Now we have left with only four item set. After that, we will generate another candidate set by using the combinations of these four transactions, that is AB, AC, AD, BC, BD, after that is CD. Now we will find these combination count from this transaction data set. After finding the combination count, we will find the support for all these three item sets. In the similar way, this item set is known as the frequent two candidate set generation. After that, in the similar way, we will apply this minimum threshold level to this transaction table, and it will give us these four item sets. After that, we will generate some kind of association rules from this, like A and B. These all these two are the highest transaction rate. That is AB with having 65% support and CD having 70% support. We will generate association rule of only the highest. You can see only the candidate set which is having the highest support count. Now we have generated the rule set, that is A with respect to B. That is A corresponds to B. The confidence level of this will be 65 divided by 65. That is, here its confidence level is 65. We will divide this by A. That is, 65 by 65 will correspond to 100% confidence level. After that, B with respect to A, that is B corresponds to A, it is equals to 65, and the probability of B is, that is 70. That is, 65 divided by 70 is 92% support. In the similar way for CD, is C corresponds to D and D corresponds to C. In the similar way, we will calculate the confidence value and the association rule for the frequent pattern item set. Now, what are the bottlenecks of a priori, or you can say that what are the disadvantages of the a priori algorithm? Mining the long pattern needs many passes of scanning and generates a lot of candidate set. That means the first bottleneck or the most important bottleneck over here is the candidate set generation. That is, here we need to generate the candidate sets again and again in order to find the frequent item set. If there is large data set, then it will take a huge amount of time in order to generate that data set. Now, in order to cover up these kind of disadvantages, we will have one more frequent item algorithm, frequent item set calculation algorithm, that is a FP growth, that is a frequent pattern growth algorithm. FP growth algorithm is as the name denotes, in this we will create one FP tree, and that FP tree basically we will recursively mine that tree in order to find the frequent item set. Now it will correspond to it consists of three steps. First one is the construction of conditional pattern base for each item set in the header table. Second is the construction of conditional FP tree from each conditional pattern base. After that, recursively mine that conditional FP tree and grow the frequent pattern obtained so far. If the conditional pattern tree contains a single path, simply enumerate all the patterns. All these three points are basically corresponds to FP growth algorithm. Now, I have explained one example over here. We have some transaction IDs and we have some item set. Firstly, we will basically order these frequent items. How we will order that? We will first count the number of F in each and every transaction, that is 1, 2, 3 and 4. F count is 4. After that, A is corresponds to 1, 2 and 3. A 3 times present, C presents 1, 2, 3 and 4. C presents 4 times. In this, we have to basically arrange the elements into the decreasing order. Like firstly, the count of F is 4. That is, it comes first in this transaction. After that, C is having the count 4. We have arranged C over here. After that, A, then M, then P. In the similar way, we will order each and every item set in the transaction ID. That is, after that, we will generate a tree. After generating the tree, we will make this header table. Now, how this tree will be generated from these transactions is, first one is F, C, A, M, P. That is F, C, A, M, and P. Each and every pattern is having the value 111 in the first, for the first item set. After second item set, it is showing us F, C, A, B, M. Then is F, C, A, B, M. Here we will corresponds to 2. C is also 2. A is also 2. These two are 11. After that, F and B. Then F, for here initially it was 2. After the third transaction, it will be going towards 3. That is F and B. B corresponds to only a single time, that is 1. In the transaction 400, we will have C, B and P. Now C here there is no column for C starting with C. We will corresponds to a single. We will generate one more branch over here. That is C, B and P. Each is having the value 1, 1 and 1. After that, for the transaction 500, we will have F, C, A and P. That is F, that is corresponds to 4. C, then A, then M and P. These two corresponds to 2. This is 3, 3 and 4. In this way, each and every transaction, order transaction, order frequent item sets will make this kind of transaction tree or this kind of conditional FP tree. Now we will generate the header table from these. F corresponds to 4, C corresponds to 3 plus 1, 4, A corresponds to 3, B corresponds to 1 plus 1 plus 1, that is 3, M corresponds to 3, how? It's 2 plus 1, 3, P corresponds to 3, that is 2 plus 1, 3. Now the frequent item F list corresponds to, it's F, C, A, B, M, P. Means these are basically the frequent items into this set. After that, we will have the conditional pattern base. How we will generate this conditional pattern base. Now for the element P. For the element P, we will have F, C, A, M. That is F, C, A, M. For 2 times, because here M is 2. That is F, C, A, M. It will generate 2 times. It will come for 2 times. After that, for the P is, this one is also, that is C and B, comes for only a single time. After that, we will have the item M, that is F, C and A. For M, we will have F, C, A for 2 times, because here for M, here the value is 2. That means this path will be covered 2 times in order to make the value of M corresponds to 2, that is FCA for 2 times. Then is FCAB, that is F, C, A and B. Here M corresponds to only a single time, that means FCAB corresponds to a single time. After that B, for the B we will take only F for the single time, only C for the single time, and it's F, C and A or only a single time. That will corresponds to 1 plus 1 plus 1, that will corresponds to 3. After that we will have A. For the A we will take F and C, that is here F and C for 3 times. That's why we have written here 3. After that C. C corresponds to here. F will corresponds to 3 times for C. And for F, F is only the single root, then we will have a null over here. In this way, we will traverse the tree by the following links for each frequent item set. And in this way, we will find the frequent item sets in the FP growth algorithm. Now, the flow chart of the algorithm. The first step is the collection of data set and the pre-processing of that data. After that, applying the rule mining and finding the frequent item sets by using the a priori algorithm and the FP growth algorithm. And after that, comparing and analyzing the results of both the algorithm. Now the tool used for both these algorithms is Java JDK, NetBeans and Weka as an external library. Now I am going to demonstrate the same project into the NetBeans. Firstly, we will do one thing. We will I will minimize this data set because it will take a lot of time in order to generate the rules for this. I think so. Now I am going to demonstrate the same project into NetBeans. That is, right click to the GUI main file. I am going to run this file. Then here we will browse the dataset first. I'm going to browse the dataset. That's the market dataset. I'm going to upload that dataset. And now showing the same dataset over here. Then I'm going to perform the mining over this dataset. What we will do, we will here find, we will here put minimum support. Let's suppose I have put over here, that is 0.4. And number of rows here I have put the 10 rows I need to generate. Minimum matrix is basically the confidence level of that particular rule. And I am going to apply the a priori algorithm. Now a priori algorithm is running over that dataset. Actually the dataset is quite large. That's why it is taking some time in order to generate the rules. The similar way we will apply the a priori FP growth algorithm. And then we will compare the time of both the algorithms. That is a how much time a priori have taken in order to generate the frequent patterns. Here it has generated basically the two item sets, that is L1 and second one is L2. L1 contains 13 items and L2 contains 7 items. And the number of rows here is, if anybody will going to buy biscuits, then how much chances, and how much chances that he will be going to buy bread and cake also. Similar is for the milk cream. If a person is going to buy a milk cream, then how many chances is there that he is going to buy a bread and cake? In the similar way, it has generated the 10 rules. Each rule is having the confidence level over here. How much confidence this rule, this particular rule will have. And the time taken to generate the rules is 17,211 milliseconds. Now I'm going to apply the FP growth algorithm over the same data set. It has shown us the rules, and the time taken for the generation of the rules by using the FP growth is 651. A priori is taking so much time is that because it is basically creating the candidate set generations also over there. In order to resolve these kinds of disadvantages from the a priori, that's why we have used basically the frequent pattern tree, that is the FP growth algorithm. Now I'm going to compare the algorithm. FP growth have taken only 651 milliseconds, and a priori algorithm have taken 17,000 of results. Now in this way, FP growth performs well as compared to a priori algorithm with respect to time. Now, what's the flowchart for the whole process? First one is the collection of the dataset, collection and pre-processing of the dataset. And then we will apply the rule mining in order to find the frequent patterns from that particular dataset by using the a priori algorithm. And then we are going to analyze the results, like what kind of rules it has generated from that particular dataset. Now, the tool used in order to create that project is Java JDK, NetBeans with Weka as an external library. Now I am going to demonstrate the same project into the NetBeans. What we will do is, I have created one project named a priori over here. I'll right click to the main file. It is gui1.java, and then click to the run file button. What it will show, it will give me one interface in which I am going to browse, I am going to upload my dataset. Now, here is the main graphical user interface. In this window, I'll first browse the dataset. What I'll do over here is, I'll just browse the dataset. From here, I have uploaded the dataset. The dataset which I have uploaded, that same dataset will be going to show over here. Like this dataset is basically the purchasing quality, or you can say that the purchasing frequency of the particular customer into that market, in order to find that customer is having the quality churn or loyal. Now after that, what I'll do is, I'll click to the next button. Here I'm going to put here what kind of minimum support, what kind of minimum threshold I'll take in order to find the frequent item sets. Here I have put 0.4, and the number of rows I have put over here is 10. Minimum matrix, that is a minimum support, that is a confidence level for that particular rule. Here I have then I'm going to click to the a priori algorithm. That is, I'm going to apply the a priori algorithm on that particular data set. Now it has generated here the two rules, basically the three item sets it has generated. That is L1, which will be going to contain the three items, L2, which is going to be contains also the three item sets, and L3 item set, which is going to contain only a single item, frequent item set. And here are some kind of rules which is it has generated. That is some kind of it has last inter purchase time difference. If its value is high, then the product quality, that is a product category, will be normal. And the similar way, if the relative monetary value of that particular customer is high and the last inter purchase time difference will be high, then the product category will be normal. These all are values, these all denotes basically the confidence level of that particular rules. And the time taken by the a priori algorithm in order to generate these 10 rules is 719 milliseconds. Now these are the results of the a priori which I have explained. I hope you have learned a lot from this lecture. Thanks for listening.